Hey guys, so now we're going to get into the part that makes this chapter really fun, and that's the mechanism. All right? So just so you guys know, I'm going to teach this section more in depth than your professor taught it for this chapter. Why is that? Well, because I realized that mechanisms are such a big part of organic chemistry that if we can learn them as early as possible, it's going to help you guys so much more later on. Okay? You don't want to be learning about mechanisms for the first time in chapter 7 or chapter 8. That would be organic suicide, all right? Because you're gonna be very confused and you're gonna have to pick up the pace a lot. So what we wanna do is we wanna just use the concept of acids and bases to introduce what the mechanism is, all right? So we're gonna talk about this in two parts. The first part is I wanna talk about the reactivity of atoms. Why do they even react? And the second part is I wanna show you how they react with electron movement. So let's go ahead and begin. So just so you guys know, the currency of organic chemistry, and I've said this before, is stability, okay? Stability. Every atom wants to become more stable. Every molecule wants to become more stable, all right? And it turns out that stability and reactivity, you hear these words all the time, actually have an inverse relationship. Inverse. What I mean by that is opposite. That means if stability goes up, reactivity is generally going to go down. If reactivity is up, that means stability goes down. Get their opposites of each other, okay? So how can we tell if a molecule is reactive or a molecule is unreactive, all right? Like I said, this is not a section that's usually covered in your textbook. I have just built this from years of teaching orgo and realizing that, hey, there's actually ways that we can predict this, okay? So there's actually four really common ways that we know that something's going to be reactive. You guys ready? And you actually know three of these four already, okay? The first one is formal charges. You guys remember those? Okay? Formal charges, what does that mean? Formal charges mean that an atom is not at its ideal bonding preference, right? It has too many or too few valence electrons, okay? Remember the sticks and the dots. So what that means is that it's going to try to do anything in its power to try to go back to its bonding preference. So that means it has a very big reason to want to react with something else. If it can get rid of some electrons, maybe it can go back to the state that it wants to be in. Does that make sense? So that's the first one. If you see a formal charge, you know that this is going to be reactive. The second one is net dipoles. Okay? So net dipoles have to do with the fact that I have asymmetrical dipoles that are not perfectly canceling out. And what that means is that I'm going to have partial charges in different places. Another way that I could say this is partial charges. Okay? So remember that a partial charge is the result of a net dipole. If I have a net dipole going to the right, that means that I would have a partial negative on one side and a partial positive on the other. Okay? So what I'm basically doing here is I'm saying if you have formal charges, a full charge, that's very reactive. But even if you have a partial charge, that's also very reactive. So now let's talk about two other things. The two other things are pi bonds, okay? What we're gonna find out is that pi bonds, remember that we went over this in the first chapter, pi bonds are not as strong as sigma bonds, right? They're actually much weaker in terms of the amount of energy that's saved. So what that means is that pi bonds are a really good source of electrons, okay? And they're gonna be pretty easy to break. Remember, sigma bonds are almost impossible to break many times, but pi bonds, they're not as stable, so they're easier to break. So pi bonds are gonna also be reactive. I know I said the word break a lot of times, but and then finally the fourth one is something you don't know yet, and that is steric effects. Okay, steric effects is something that we're gonna talk about more when we talk about basically cycloalkanes, and we're gonna talk about a bunch of other stuff a little bit later. But an example of steric effect I just want to tell you would be like something like ring strain. So imagine that I have a three-membered ring. And these bond angles are very, very, very tight. Usually those bond angles would want to be like 109.5, but instead they're like 60 degrees. That's an example of ring strain. That means that these bond angles are not stable because of the fact that they're, you know, they're just not at their ideal position, all right? And that's also going to make molecules reactive. Now, do you need to deal with this one right now? No, but I just wanted to be comprehensive and let you know those are like the four major things that make organic molecules reactive. Cool? So what I want to do is move on to an exercise, and I want you guys to look at these eight different compounds and just go ahead and look at the first box. The first box is literally a checkbox. I want you to either check off that it is reactive or put an X on it if it is not reactive. So I want you to go through maybe A through D, the first four, and I want you guys to look at those first four and see if you can find any of those four reasons why it would be reactive. If you can't, then that means it's not going to be reactive.